Natural spring water is a water for every occasion. On the field of sports, at your workplace, just open the bottle and savor the pure, refreshing taste. Holy Natural Spring Water is produced in Mama Can St. Andrews and is available in all sizes nationwide. To order, telephone 444-7654 or 533-7654. Holy Natural Spring Water. Grenada's purest bottled water.
Kite flying contributes significantly to power outages on our system. In fact, from January 2017 to March 2019, we had 143 kite flying incidents on our system affecting over 31,000 customers. This approximates to about two-thirds of our customer base. We also have power surges, and these are spikes in electrical current which can negatively impact electronics and other appliances in the home and businesses as well. When kites entangle our lines and the lines clashes, you have sparks which can fall to the ground and cause bushfires as well.
Greenlink operates a network that where voltages range from 230 volts all the way up to 33,000 volts. At that level, basically any sort of contact with the lines can result in electrocution, especially when you're not contacting the lines with proper safety equipment. A kite is simply pieces of fabric that can be moist depending on the conditions outside, and so at the higher voltages the risk of electrocution is definitely possible.
It's a major strain on the company's resource to restore power after a distribution cut caused by kite flying. We have to send the crews out there to first of all investigate, then to restore power. We recognize that kite flying is a very important tradition to the Grenadian public. However, we would like them to do it safely by staying away from power lines to avoid personal injuries and disruption to the service to our customers.
This Easter, be safe, be considerate, fly your kites in wide open spaces away from power lines.
Greenlink, energizing our community.
Hello and welcome to the MTV Evening News for Tuesday, March 12, 2024. The news headlines come to you in association with Quartz Grenada Limited.
Pick your daily reward from the Quartz Ready Cash Money Tree. Every customer is a winner with every loan of $3,000 or more from Quartz Ready Cash. Plus, you get to enter to win a weekend for two at Sandals. No deposit, no collateral needed. All you need is your ID, proof of address, pay slip, job letter, and two references. Visit your nearest Quartz or Ready Cash location today or apply online at www.quartz.com. Get more for 2024 with Quartz Ready Cash. We are ready when you are. Conditions apply.
Coming up in the news tonight, Kariku resident charged with stepdaughter's murder remanded to prison. Four police officers charged in connection with prisoner's escape. Ministry of Agriculture invest 1.3 million EC to assist farmers. And in sports, a competitive first day in the Republic Bank Intercall Games. The details when we come back.
The first segment of the MTV Evening News comes to your compliment, Nexa Credit Union. With you, wherever your road leads.
But when you need someone to help you to your feet, I'll be that beacon to your highest peak. Ooh, I'll be right next to you, no, I will never leave. Come on, take my hands, we got everything we need. Cause you can look to me,
yes, I can.
Whenever you're in need,
yes, you can.
Just call on me and I'll be on my way. I'll be by your side,
by your side.
Never to divide,
yeah. Nexa Credit Union, with you, wherever your road leads.
Good evening. With the news in detail, I am Troy Gill. A 30-year-old Lauriston resident charged with the murder of his teenage stepdaughter made his first court appearance at the St. George's No. 1 Magistrates Court on Tuesday, surrounded by police. He was remanded to prison to return to court later this month.
The 30-year-old, self-employed, who resides in Lauriston, Carriacou, was charged with the offense of non-capital murder by intentionally causing the death of his stepdaughter, 14-year-old Esther Patterson, by unlawful harm. According to the Royal Grenada Police Force, the offense is alleged to have been committed on Friday, 8th March 2024 at Lauriston, Carriacou. Alexis is represented by criminal attorney Jerry Edwin, who told MTV News that his client gave a clear report to the police on what transpired.
This is a matter that was transferred to the St. George's Court, where the Honorable Francine Foster, our chief magistrate, sits. It will be transferred to Carriacou, which is the proper jurisdiction, because that's where the crime occurred. And I can say it's a crime, and I can say where it occurred, because Mr. Joseph gave very detailed statement to the police as to his role. He admitted his role in the death of his stepdaughter.
MTV News understands that apart from non-capital murder, there was mention of other allegations before the court. However, Edwin could not provide details. The matter will proceed straight to the High Court.
But Mr. Joseph was very coherent. He's calm. He understood that the reason he was in the court, the nature of the charges he faced. He made a statement voluntarily with the police. A statement under caution, meaning that it will be accepted by the High Court. So we will be moving by paper committal to bring the matter to the High Court.
Edwin believes that given the number of violent crimes on island, there is a need to move speedily to avoid a backlog in criminal cases and deliver swift justice.
And we are concerned that the perception that justice somehow is taking the scenic route in Grenada. That is hardly the case. We are moving swiftly on the defense side without compromising in any way the defense of our client. But procedurally, administratively, we want these matters to be heard as quickly as possible so that we do not have delays of 6 years, 5 years, 4 years for a trial to be held. So I think it's in everybody's interest that we move expeditiously to avoid delay.
During a press briefing on Tuesday, Prime Minister and Minister for National Security, Honorable Dickon Mitchell, addressed the issue of sexual violence against women and children.
For the young 14-year-old victim in Carriacou, who was brutally killed last Friday. And so I want to spend a little time talking about sexual violence against women and children. And the need for us to come to terms as a society with the fact that we have a major problem that we can no longer sweep under the carpet or turn a blind eye to or pretend does not exist. It is not a problem the police can solve. By the time the police is involved, as clearly is the case last Friday, it is way too late.
Alexis will return to court on March 27th for mention. The preliminary hearing begins on April 16th. Reporting for MTV News, I am Akila Aberdeen.
Meanwhile, Kevin Penny, 36 years old, unemployed of Vendom St. George, who was charged with non-capital murder in the death of Jason Joseph in May 2023, appeared at the St. George's Magistrates Court on Tuesday in connection with a charge of grievous harm against several police officers and damage to property. Penny allegedly committed the offences while on remand at His Majesty's prison. He is represented by attorney Jerry Edwin.
Yes, Mr. Penny was brought here for a different matter at the South St. George Police Station, where a couple of police officers alleged that they were attacked by him and stabbed and so forth. So we're working with our client because there are some underlying issues there we are assisting him with as well. My client, Mr. Penny, is facing non-capital murder charges also and attempted murder charges. We will deal with all of those matters in the High Court because they are indictable. So there's a bit of work that we still must do on behalf of our clients.
Four police officers are facing disciplinary action following an investigation into the circumstances surrounding the escape of three fugitives. However, ongoing investigations may also implicate the leadership at the South St. George Police Station. More in this report.
In a significant development, four officers attached to the South St. George Police Station have been formally charged in connection with the escape of the three prisoners, Ron Mitchell, Atiba Stanislaus, and Trevon Robertson, who escaped from the South St. George Police Station on February 18th. The fugitives managed to evade police custody and fled to St. Vincent. They were later apprehended and jointly charged with two counts of capital murder by intentionally causing the death of U.S. nationals Ralph Hendry and Kathleen Brandel. Prime Minister and Minister for National Security, Honorable Deacon Mitchell, during a press conference with Police High Command on Tuesday, provided insights into the circumstances surrounding the prisoners' escape following an investigation launched by Commissioner of Police Don McKenzie that implicates the police officers.
The three prisoners had not been placed inside of the individual cells which had the secure locking mechanism. But instead, at the time of the escape, they were in a corridor which had burglar bars and which were immediately located outside of the four individual locking cells. By their being there, it allowed them to bend the wrought iron or iron grill that secures that corridor area and to escape.
According to Prime Minister Mitchell, if the men were placed in the four locking cells at the station, they would not have escaped. He divulged the identities of the officers, including a senior police official, subject to disciplinary actions due to negligence.
Disciplinary action has been taken against, so far, four police officers who were charged this morning. Constable 224 Shah George, Constable 520 Baptiste, Corporal 624 Edwards, and Detective Sergeant Lewis. They have been charged with various offenses under the Police Act, ranging from making a false statement, permitting the escape of a prisoner, and breaches of standing orders in various counts.
The leadership at the helm of the South St. George Police Station could also face disciplinary action, Mitchell revealed.
It is also clear that the leadership at the station is a matter that requires attention as well. And the Commissioner of Police has also commissioned an investigation to review the role of the leadership at the station at the time, and when that investigation is completed, given that the leadership falls for the purposes of disciplinary purposes to the Public Service Commission, the necessary report will be submitted to the Public Service Commission, and the Public Service Commission will then choose to do what it is empowered to do.
MTV News understands that Assistant Superintendent of Police Sheldon Thomas was the officer in charge at the South St. George Police Station during the incident. Commissioner Don McKenzie confirmed that despite being charged, the officers in question have not been sent on leave but will continue to carry on their duties. For MTV News, Kayla Flavany.
Meanwhile, Prime Minister and Minister for National Security, Honorable Dickon Mitchell, disclosed that following a report on recent events, a comprehensive assessment is currently underway to evaluate infrastructure and security measures at all police stations. This assessment includes a focus on implementing enhanced security measures to ensure prisoners are adequately detained while in police custody.
Review and, if necessary, the strengthening of the outer cell doors of all police stations where cells are located to minimize and reduce the risk of unauthorized access is currently underway. The implementation of self-contained cell clusters with integrated toilet and bathroom facilities will also be implemented. And in more basic terms, what that means is that we have police stations where there are no bathroom and toilet facilities immediately where the cells are. The effect of this is that prisoners or persons in police custody would essentially have to be moved from these cells to other locations within the police station to do basic things like use the bathroom or the toilet.
In addition to bolstering security measures, including the installation of surveillance cameras, Mitchell also revealed plans to review the procedures for handling prisoners.
Limits the movement of prisoners from self-contained cell clusters has to be implemented. The enhanced and comprehensive use of closed-circuit television or CCTV to cover entrances and exits to cells and the cells themselves will be implemented across all police stations that have cells. The review and enhancement of protocols for the handling of prisoners. It is clear that in light of the finding of the report, of the investigation, that the standard operating procedures were not followed, that it is absolutely vital for the republishing, reiterating, and the enforcing of the police standing orders, particularly those relating to prisoner handling.
Furthermore, the transportation and escorting of prisoners will undergo a thorough review, he affirms, particularly high-profile detainees. That's the first segment of news. More news when we come back.
The first segment of the MTV Evening News came to you in association with Nexa Credit Union, with you wherever your road leads.
But when you need someone to help you to your feet, I'll be that beacon to your highest peak. Ooh, I'll be right next to you, no, I will never leave. Come on, take my hands, we got everything we need. Cause you can look to me,
yes, I can.
Whenever you're in need,
yes, you can.
Just call on me and I'll be on my way.
Nexa Credit Union, with you, wherever your road leads.
Wow, it's InstaCash Grenada. Imagine a game with no numbers to choose from, no draws to wait on, and you can play it every day, including Sunday. That's InstaCash. It's fast, it's easy to play, and you win prizes instantly. InstaCash. Must be 18 years or older to play. NLA, making dreams come true.
When a loved one passes on, we all need the comfort, support, and guidance of a trusted friend. You can rely on LaCour Brothers Funeral Home. We provide a personalized professional service that exceeds all expectations. Our dedicated staff responds to your every need with the greatest detail, ensuring affordability with a variety of options. Upgraded state-of-the-art facilities, spacious air-conditioned chapel with live internet streaming, a modern, environmentally safe crematorium, the only of its kind on island, private viewing spaces, large on-site repair center, and modern transportation fleet. Join our burial society today and make personalized arrangements for that final moment. As you prepare to enter your loved one into eternal rest, visit or call LaCour Brothers Funeral Home and select a package that brings added comfort to the entire family. LaCour Brothers Funeral Home and Burial Society, continuing a tradition of excellence.
Are you in the diaspora missing the taste of home? Well, now you can order your limited edition rum from Grenada Distillers. Simply click on the link provided and fill out the form to secure your bottle at Nick's Barrel House. Or you can have someone collect your order for you. And for our local customers, if you order 2 bottles or more, we can deliver right to your doorstep. For more information, contact us at Nick's Barrel House at 444-5363 or DM us on our Instagram and Facebook pages at Grenada Distillers. Clark's Court Rum. Enjoy responsibly.
It's time to hit the road again with Grenada Cooperative Bank Limited for the annual Pump It Up Family Fun Walk. Gather your friends, bring out the family, organize your group, come out in your numbers and pump it up to a healthier lifestyle while supporting a worthy cause. Join us in Karakou on April 14th at 4 p.m. as we pump it up from the Harveydale playing field to the Hillsborough playing field. Then we bring the action to the mainland on April 21st at 4 p.m. from Monrouge playing field to Kirani James Athletic Stadium. It's a fun family affair with lots of prizes and giveaways. Register today because this is the final fundraising push for the re-establishment of the Carlton home. Individual packages are $20, while packages for groups of 3 or more are $15 each while stocks last. Register online at www.grenadacoopbank.com or at any one of our retail banking units. Visit our website for more details.
Welcome home.
Hi, good day. My name is Kyle Sylvester. I am the manager and founder of Case Farming Enterprise. We're an agro-processing business that are involved in the processing of agricultural goods, where we do bottle seasoning, seasoning packs, lettuce, kale, and broccoli. Sometimes we as human beings get sick or injured on the job. NS provides a safety net for us. I am here to encourage other entrepreneurs and self-employed persons to sign up under the NS Self-Employment Program.
Get ready to witness the ultimate showcase of talent, speed, and determination at the 2024 Carifta Games. This prestigious event brings together the best young athletes from across the Caribbean, competing for glory like never before. With the motto, many people, one region, celebrating athletics, Carifta embodies the essence of Caribbean unity through sports, igniting a flame that illuminates the future of sports in the region. Don't miss out on this incredible event taking place at the Kirani James Athletic Stadium from Saturday 30th March to Monday 1st April 2024. Get your tickets now at Grenadian Optical or visit gotofed.com and secure your spot to be part of this extraordinary celebration of athleticism.
The second segment of MTV News is brought to you in association with Arisa Credit Union. Your financial freedom, your future.
Take charge of your financial journey by switching to an own your own loan at Arisa Credit Union. Arisa's own your own loan is as unique as you are because we know one size fits all does not fit you. With own your own loan, you get unmatched benefits including lower interest rates, flexible repayment options, discounted loan and legal fees, and savings from hardware suppliers. Tailor-made options that put you in control. Switch now and step into the life you were always meant to live with Arisa's Own Your Own Loan. Arisa Credit Union. Your financial freedom. Your future. Call us today at 440-1759 or visit our website at arisacu.com.
Welcome back.
In efforts to broaden the scope of assistance to farmers, the Ministry of Agriculture and Lands, Forestry and Marine Resources has invested EC $1.3 million under the Agricultural Development Assistance Program, formerly the Farm Assistance Program. Kayla Flavini has this report.
In 2023, a whopping EC $50 million was invested into the Agricultural Development Assistance Program. This year, the Ministry of Agriculture has increased its aid to ensure that there is full coverage of assistance to all farmers in the Tri-Island. Acting Permanent Secretary in the Ministry of Agriculture and Lands, Forestry and Marine Resources is Isaac Bagwan.
You do not want the same farmer to be benefiting over and over, but we want to be able to spread the resources so that we could get maximum input. There is a huge demand on the local market, and our first objective is to satisfy that local demand, and of course other programs of the ministry will add support in terms of other areas so that we can get to the point of export and value added.
This year, emphasis will be placed on two of the largest areas, the provision of labor support to 450 medium-sized farmers, including land clearing and the planting of crops, among others, to the tune of EC $405,000. The second point of focus will be on the provision of labor support to 50 farmers who cultivate 10 or more acres of land. EC $90,000 is budgeted for this cause.
So the program is not strictly just labor per se, but other means of support will be provided for farmers. As I've mentioned, the program would be implemented through the Ministry of Agriculture, the Extension Division. However, we do have a number of additional persons that we have brought in to be able to provide support.
The National Coordinator of the Agricultural Development Assistance Program, or ADAP, John Andrew, stated that the program is fully prepared to equip farmers with the necessary tools and skills needed to improve their craft. Andrew is appealing to farmers to select the appropriate areas of focus that they would like ADAP to assist with.
We'll have to ascertain who are best suited to benefit from that kind of assistance. Farmers must have the potential. So we will have to assess to make sure that farmers have the capacity to make good use of the support that they will get into the program. Because we want, at the end of the day, we want to promote sustainability, we want to promote increased production, and we have to make sure that the money is well spent for farmers who deserve to have those levels of support.
For MTV News, Kayla Flavini.
On Monday, CARICOM convened Haitian stakeholders, Caribbean leaders, and international development partners in Jamaica to urgently discuss a solution to halt Haiti's spiraling crisis. They agreed on a joint proposal to establish a transitional council. Prime Minister Honorable Dickon Mitchell stated that due to engagements on island, he was unable to attend the meeting. However, prior to Monday, he has been involved in many discussions to aid in combating the situation in Haiti.
We've spent, in particular since the CARICOM meeting in Guyana, almost every day of the week, sometimes on calls all the way to 2-3 a.m. in the morning, dealing with the Haiti issue, keeping it alive, keeping it at the international forefront, getting our partners, the Canadians, the Americans, the French, the UK, in particular our colleagues in Kenya and Benin, Mexico, to really come on board to try and support the initiative, to first find a political strategy to transition in towards elections, because we are...
The decision is to create a transitional presidential council comprised of 7 voting members and 2 non-voting observers. Upon the establishment of the transitional presidential council, Prime Minister of Haiti, Ariel Henry, announced his resignation. Prime Minister Mitchell declared his commitment to a transitional governance arrangement.
He felt it was important that there be a clear signal from him that in fact that path to a transitioning to having a council that will oversee the elections in Haiti happened, and to a large extent our conversation has been about getting him to understand and to cooperate with all those involved in making sure that can happen. And the second part of it is, as you recognize, the security situation in Haiti is of major, major consequence, but we feel the political situation has to be addressed first, which we feel will then enhance the security situation and give the opportunity for hopefully to have Haitian buy-in for a multinational security force who can come in to assist the Haitians with ensuring that the security environment is safe for that transition, for the holding of elections, and for the protecting of Haitian institutions and the restoration of democratic governance.
The Ministry of Education recently launched its Technology Clubs in Schools initiative at the McDonald College. This is the first of its kind in Grenada, done in collaboration with the Restore a Sense of ICANN organization. The clubs will be run by secondary students with support of IT teachers and will be expected to spearhead tech work throughout the school. Club members will be involved in coding, robotics, and digital media while promoting the use of technology in solving real-world problems. Education Minister Honorable David Andrew welcomes the initiative.
And the prospects for the Tech Club, I'm very happy. And thanks to my team for having done that and taken us. And thanks to you for collaborating to see that happen. You can expect more. Students, you can expect more. Because we are convinced of how important this is from a government point of view and from a Ministry of Education point of view.
The Ministry of Education is working towards the development of a learning management system and improving the infrastructure for digitization and programming, inclusive of training IT teachers in coding and other areas. Chief Education Officer Dominic Jeremiah encouraged students to embrace the opportunity.
This is another ICT initiative of the Ministry of Education, and the minister will speak to that. But it is important that we recognize the partnership that exists between CAPS, the Ministry of Education, and RSE. I'm extremely happy today that this is coming to fruition.
That's the second segment of news. Stay with us.
The second segment of MTV News was brought to you in association with Arisa Credit Union. Your financial freedom, your future.
Take charge of your financial journey by switching to an Own Your Own Loan at Arisa Credit Union. Arisa's Own Your Own Loan is as unique as you are, because we know one size fits all does not fit you. With Own Your Own Loan, you get unmatched benefits including lower interest rates, flexible repayment options, discounted loan and legal fees, and savings from hardware suppliers. Tailor-made options that put you in control. Switch now and step into the life you were always meant to live with Arisa's Own Your Own Loan. Arisa Credit Union. Your financial freedom, your future. Call us today at 440-1759 or visit our website at arisacu.com.
The National Lotteries Authority is a proud sponsor of many cultural activities within the Triland State of Grenada.
My name is Anderson Matheson, also known as Leftist, and I'm a calypsonian and string band music player from Kiariko. I support the games of the National Lottery Authority because culture benefits tremendously. Annually, the NLA supports the Kiariko and Pretty Martin Carnival, the Kiariko String Band Music Festival, and all regattas, among other activities. When I play the game of the NLA, I can see where my money goes, and it's an investment into our culture.
Yes, Grenada, when you play the games of the NLA, you enable us to invest in the skills and talents of our people in the areas of sports, culture, and nation building.
What is it?
No, what?
Nice.
Yeah.
Number one.
Yeah.
Me too, man.
Whether sipped, neat,
mixed into a classic cocktail or savored on the rocks. Our rum delivers a taste that captivates and satisfies. Choose greatness. Choose Classcoat, the number one rum. Produced by the Grenada Distillers Limited.
Hi, my name is Dwayne Thompson, co-owner and founder of Sweet Grenada Tours, Taxi and Rental. We provide transportation tours in the field of tourism. Being in the field of tourism, the pandemic have taught us that we need all the help we can get, which the NIS has been very helpful in doing so. But as a small business owner, we are even more excited right now with the new initiative that the NIS have launched, providing a little bit more flexibility for small businesses like ourselves. So we definitely encourage all of the small business to consider getting on board with the NIS and this new initiative that allows the level of flexibility that they have implemented.
The Planning and Development Authority of Grenada, PDA, is enforcing regulations to curb illegal, disorderly, and unauthorized development in several locations throughout the state of Grenada. The authority is concerned that structures mainly associated with vending are negatively impacting the environment, has undesirable public health and sanitation consequences, present obstructions to vehicle and pedestrian traffic, can become projectiles during adverse weather conditions, and generally affect the aesthetics of the nation. The PDA will work along with stakeholder ministries and institutions to effect the demolition, removal, and disposal of structures which fall in the category of illegal and disorderly development, commencing January 2024. In this regard, persons who vend in or occupy such illegal structures are advised to secure their personal belongings and have the structures removed ahead of the planned PDA demolition operations. These actions of the PDA have become necessary to safeguard and protect public health and the environment, ensure the safety and well-being of all citizens and visitors, discourage any future disorderly construction, and encourage compliance to regulations pertaining to physical development in the state of Grenada. This is a message from the Planning and Development Authority of Grenada.
It's time to hit the road again with Grenada Cooperative Bank Limited for the annual Pump It Up Family Fun Walk. Gather your friends, bring out the family, organize your group, come out in your numbers, and pump it up to a healthier lifestyle while supporting a worthy cause. Join us in Karaku on April 14th at 4 p.m. as we pump it up from the Harvey Vale playing field to the Hillsboro playing field. Then we bring the action to the mainland on April 21st at 4 p.m. from Monrouge playing field to Kirani James Athletic Stadium. It's a fun family affair with lots of prizes and giveaways. Register today because this is the final fundraising push for the re-establishment of the Carlton home. Individual packages are $20, while packages for groups of three or more are $15 each while stocks last. Register online at www.grenadacoopbank.com or at any one of our retail banking units. Visit our website for more details.
Hello everybody, this is Kirani James. As you can see, here I'm at the Cuthbert Peters Park in Guelph, doing some training for the 2024 Olympics. As we all know, sports gives us so much, right? It gives us a dream, it gives us discipline, it gives us a sense of community. That's why I want to encourage everyone, every single kid, to the GFA National Grassroots Program. There are over 33 grassroots centers across Grenada, Carriacou, and Pitimatnik. So I want to encourage your parents, everyone, if you want your kids to be a part of a football program so that they can get a proper foundation, not just in sports, but to help them be upstanding members of society. I encourage you to join the grassroots programs and to participate in it so that your kids could have some success. Thank you.
Boyo, they gonna fly with kite now. The wind picking up.
I'm coming. Kaim, what you doing?
Fly my kite.
Yeah, but not here. You can't fly kite in the power lines, boy.
Why not? The wind good.
Because mommy say, kite treads conduct electricity.
Yeah, Kai. He's right. If your kite gets stuck in power lines, it can cause power outages, or even worse, it can get shot.
Come, let me go and fly them in the pasture.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Gwenlick, energizing our Grenada.
Now for this evening's regional roundup.
With the regional roundup, I am Clifton James. An American tourist died on a cruise ship that was en route to the Bahamas. The Royal Bahamas Police Force said it received reports that the woman, a 27-year-old Florida resident, was found unresponsive in her cabin around 5:30 p.m. on Monday. A team of medical personnel from the ship assisted and performed CPR, but no vital signs of life were detected and she was declared deceased. During their initial investigation, officers confiscated a quantity of suspected cocaine from the cabin and arrested a 32-year-old American male from Florida, police reported. An autopsy will be conducted to determine the exact cause of death. Investigations into the matter are ongoing. A search is underway on the British Virgin Islands for three Colombian tourists who went missing on Sunday. The Immigration Department reported Jean Carlos Olpina Cardo, Pamela Mesa Escobar and Yessi Johanna Martin Ramirez arrived on the UK overseas territory via the cruise ship Norwegian Sky and did not return to the vessel. Anyone with information on their whereabouts is asked to contact the Department of Immigration. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken on Monday announced an additional $100 million to finance the deployment of a multinational force to Haiti following a meeting with CARICOM leaders in Jamaica to halt the country's violent crisis. Blinken also announced another $33 million in humanitarian aid and the creation of a joint proposal agreed on by Caribbean leaders and all of the Haitian stakeholders to expedite a political transition and create a presidential college. He said the college would take concrete steps he did not identify to meet the needs of the Haitian people and enable the pending deployment of the multinational force to be led by Kenya. Blinken also noted that the US Department of Defense doubled its support for the mission, having previously set aside $100 million. The joint proposal has the backing of CARICOM, a regional trade bloc that held Monday's urgent meeting. You're up to date with the regional roundup. I am Clifton James.
This is the MTV Evening News. More news when we come back.
Pick your daily reward from the Quartz Ready Cash Money Tree. Every customer is a winner with every loan of $3,000 or more from Quartz Ready Cash. Plus, you get to enter to win a weekend for two at Sandals. No deposit, no collateral needed. All you need is your ID, proof of address, pay slip, job letter, and two references. Visit your nearest Quartz or Ready Cash location today or apply online at www.quartz.com. Get more for 2024 with Quartz Ready Cash. We are ready when you are. Conditions apply.
Wow, it's InstaCash Grenada. Imagine a game with no numbers to choose from, no draws to wait on, and you can play it every day, including Sunday. That's InstaCash. It's fast, it's easy to play, and you win prizes instantly. InstaCash. Must be 18 years or older to play. NLA, making dreams come true.
My name is Alimaka Motley. I've been here doing nails since 2017. Me being self-employed, I have realized that paying the NIS benefits me now and even when I retire. By the time I'm 65, I will be receiving contributions back from NIS. So I benefit. Because I'm self-employed, anything can happen. If anything happens, to you while you're at work. You've got a bad cold, you have the COVID, you have dengue, we have all these diseases that's plaguing us at the moment. NIS will be giving you back some form of money when you're ill. So I would encourage all small business persons to sign up with NIS now.
The Planning and Development Authority of Grenada, PDA, is enforcing regulations to curb illegal, disorderly, and unauthorized development in several locations throughout the state of Grenada. The authority is concerned that structures mainly associated with vending are negatively impacting the environment, has undesirable public health and sanitation consequences, present obstructions to vehicle and pedestrian traffic, can become projectiles during adverse weather conditions, and generally affect the aesthetics of the nation. The PDA will work along with stakeholder ministries and institutions to effect the demolition, removal, and disposal of structures which fall in the category of illegal and disorderly development, commencing January 2024. In this regard, persons who vend in or occupy such illegal structures are advised to secure their personal belongings and have the structures removed ahead of the planned PDA demolition operations. These actions of the PDA have become necessary to safeguard and protect public health and the environment, ensure the safety and well-being of all citizens and visitors, discourage any future disorderly construction, and encourage compliance to regulations pertaining to physical development in the state of Grenada. This is a message from the Planning and Development Authority of Grenada.
Grenek Community Partnership Initiative.
We applied to Grenek for the construction of a new library at Dover Government School. We've given them a library space that is comfortable, that is homey, that has customized furniture, outfitted for a child who really, really wants to enjoy reading. I want to thank the Grenada Electricity Services. We could not have done it without you, and we look forward to continued partnership into the future.
Grenek, energizing our community.
A competitive first day in the Republic Bank Intercall Games. That story and more coming up in sports.
The MTV Evening Sports is brought to you in association with Quartz, bringing value home.
It's the annual frame event at Quartz Optical, so don't miss out. Get up to 80% off your favorite frames. Call 405-9622 to book your free eye examination or book online at quartzoptical.com. Get that frame today and pay later. It's the annual frame event only at Quartz Optical. Value you can see. Conditions apply.
Now for this evening's sporting highlights.
And of course, sporting fans, we begin with an exciting day at the start of the Republic Bank Intercall Games at the Karani James Athletic Stadium on Tuesday. The games began with an opening ceremony with remarks from key stakeholders. One of the highlights of day one was a newly introduced March Pass competition, which was held during the intermission. Now remember, 14 schools are competing in the boys category and 18 schools will vie for the title in the female group. Here are some of the highlights.
Grenada SDA Bishop's College is there, St. David's SAS, and the Academy School GSS. It is Adela College of
This feels great. I know what I had to come out here and do. This morning I came out here and I warmed up properly. I knew what the task had to be done. And I came out here and I executed my race properly.
Actually, I didn't expect to like place that high,
Because like last year, I come like maybe like 3 before the last or something like that.
So what do you think leads to coming that high?
Training and just like the coaches on the money side, they go push and they push.
Grenadian footballers will have the opportunity during this week's Caribbean Premier Showcase to impress coaches from foreign universities who are on the island scouting for talent among local players. Head coach at Baker University, Nick Aguilar, is excited about the prospects.
We expect to be able to work with some players and see them up close and kind of see what Grenada has to offer from a footballing perspective. And ultimately the goal is to identify a player that can potentially come to Baker on a scholarship and play and study for 4 years and get a degree and play soccer at a high level.
Also looking on will be a coaching team from Lincoln University.
I expect it to probably be maybe 40 or so players that, you know, some have been in and out or in the national team, U20 and the senior team. I'm excited. We're NCAA Division II school, so we're always trying to find the best talent from all over the world. You know, so again, coming down here to Grenada, it makes sense because there's loads of talent that's out there. And one of the key things is, you know, when you mix talent with academics, that is perfect for universities.
Ghana will be sending 23 athletes to compete at the 2024 CARIFTA Games in Grenada. Among the team of talented athletes are Commonwealth Youth Games 400-meter champion Tiana Springer, along with Javon Roberts, Nerissa McPherson, Atoria Harvey, and Malachi Austin. The 2024 CARIFTA Games, slated to take place from the 30th of March to the 1st of April, will be at the Karani James Stadium. Cricket West Indies President Dr. Kishore Shallow believes that they have made significant strides in raising the profile of the women's game over the past year, as he reaffirmed the regional body's commitment to achieve pay parity by 2027. Shallow, in a message to mark International Women's Day on Friday, pointed to the changes in travel for overseas tours, single-room accommodation, and the launch of a women's cricket academy in Antigua. All as measures implemented to bring the women's game on par with their male counterparts. Shallow explained that the launch of the inaugural Women's Cricket Academy in Antigua is a pivotal initiative aimed at nurturing and cultivating the immense talent of our region's female cricketers. For the women's competitions, the Super 50 Cup winners will receive $20,000, while the 2020 Blaze champions will collect $10,000. The latest sporting highlights there for you. Tony Julian here. Good night.
That's the sports, the weather, and a recap of the headlines when we come back.
The MTV Evening Sports was brought to you in association with Quartz, bringing value home.
TV Weather Report comes to you in association with Grenlec, energizing our Grenada.
Boyo, they gonna fly with kite now. The wind picking up.
I'm coming. Karim, what you doing?
Fly my kite.
Yeah, but not here. You can't fly kite near power lines, boy.
Why not? The wind good?
Because mommy say, kite sheds conduct electricity.
Grenlec, energizing our Grenada.
Good evening, viewers. Once again, with the nighttime weather forecast, I'm meteorologist Wayne Williams. After some much needed and much appreciated showers during the morning time, the sunny and hot conditions continued into the afternoon and into the evening. Winds also were a bit gusty, but coming to the latter part of the evening again, we did see that quieting down a bit. The showers were brought by the remnants of a very weak trough line across the islands that has since dissipated, so we can expect fair weather to continue. Keeping our eyes on another frontal system that has entered the Northern Caribbean is very weak, so we expect that it would dissipate as it approaches the central Caribbean islands and not expect it to move into the southern region with any major force. The slight haze, not expected to affect us. Most of that haze is heading towards South America. So we can expect some very clear days for the next 4 or 5 days. Maybe by Sunday, we could see some slight haze returning. Right now, the remnants of that cloudiness with that weak trough line is going to continue to bring one or two more showers over the central Caribbean islands. We can expect conditions to improve and continue to be fair throughout the nighttime. The forecast for Tuesday night, clear and windy skies. The moon, moon is going to set at 8:43, that's tonight, and rise tomorrow at 8:44 in the morning. Clear and windy conditions throughout the night. Any showers, very light, very brief, mostly in the northern and central parts of the island. Easterly winds 8 to 18 miles per hour. Minimum temperature still around 23, but a 30% chance of those odd showers I spoke about. Sunny and hot again on Wednesday. Easterly winds would continue between 10 and 22 miles per hour. Moderate to slightly choppy seas with 4 to 5 foot waves. Sunrise at 6:15. Sunset 6:17. Temperature again climbing to around 30. This time feeling like 35. The UV index will be moderate. Mostly sunny skies in both Port of Spain and Bridgetown. A bit more clouds in Bridgetown. Sunny in Port of Spain and Kingston. A bit more clouds in Bridgetown. Still, it will be mostly fair there. Miami and New York remain partly cloudy, and a bit of clouds rolling into London. Back at home, the mostly fair conditions, sunny in the daytime would continue. Possibility of the slight haze returning by Sunday and slight increase in cloudiness from Monday into Tuesday. But by and large, not much chance of rain, 10 to 20%. Temperatures in the daytime, early 30s, 30 to 31, and in the night, between 23 and 24. That is it for me for Tuesday night, folks. Have yourself a great night. Remember, you can join me again on Wednesday.
MTV Weather Report was brought to you in association with Grenlec, energizing our Grenada.
Now to end the news, a recap of the headlines. Kariku resident charged with stepdaughter's murder, remanded to prison. Four police officers charged in connection with prisoner's escape. Ministry of Agriculture invest 1.3 million EC to assist farmers. And in sports, a competitive first day in the Republic Bank Intercall Games. On behalf of the news and production departments, I am Troy Gill. Thanks for watching. Good night.
What's special about it? Thaddeus Raymond Francis, also known as Pattern and Breads of Woodlands St. George, former employee of Gravel and Concrete, passed away on Saturday, 24th February 2024, at the age of 66, left to mourner his children, Mariella Francis, Diana and Raymond Clark, sisters Ernest Griffith, Onitha Jack, and Leonardine Francis Dasoul in Trinidad. Four grandchildren, nephews Richard Francis in Trinidad, Sperry Coutain, Robert Jack, and many others too numerous to mention. Nieces Glenda and Eslyn Coutain, Lynette, and many others too numerous to mention. Sister-in-law Anne Griffith. Close friends Alvina Clark and Rion Braffitt. Other relatives and friends, including the Francis family of Latente and Pomeroy's, the Griffith and Coutain families of Woodlands, staff at Gravel and Concrete, and neighbors and friends of Woodlands and surrounding areas. The funeral of the late Thaddeus Raymond Francis, also known as Pattern and Breads, of Woodlands St. George, will take place on Wednesday, March 13th at 1 p.m. Funeral service will be held at the Victory Seventh-day Adventist Church, Woodlands, and interment will be at the Family Cemetery, Woodlands. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Bailey's Funeral Home. Veronica Crony, also known as Tanti Marge of St. Paul, St. George, passed away on Saturday, 17th February 2024, at the age of 87. She was the mother of Maureen Batiste and Sally Ann Crony Hall in the USA, Rafael Crony, Derek Crony, and Debbie Crony Latouche in Grenada, grandmother of Her Excellency Rochelle Crony in the UK, Amanda Batiste and Carlene Hall in the USA, Dijon Crony, Darren Crony, Clint Crony, Carly and Joseph, Kyle Hall, and Dekela Latouche in Grenada, great-grandmother of Robert Johnson and Azari Hall in the USA, Carissa Hall, and Malik Joseph in Grenada, great-great-grandmother of Jakari, JC, and Rain Johnson in the USA, mother-in-law of William Batiste in the USA, Carlisle Hall, Claude Latouche, Cheryl Crony, and Laura Crony in Grenada, grandmother-in-law of Michaela Crony, Raquel Crony, and Melvin Joseph. Several nieces and nephews, including Helen Ann Garraway, Abigail Gooding, Erilyn Garraway, Glendalyn Garraway, Phyllis, and Paul Hanney. Many cousins, other relatives and friends, including Jacinta Young, Carvel Modeste, Tracy Crony, Victor Bishop, the Garraway families of St. Paul's and Springs, the Gooding, Hanney, Cadet, Bishop, Lessie, Bub, Cador and Arnold families of St. Paul's, the Crony family of Holderhill and Telescope, the Lawrence and Charles families of Laverney, the Charles family of Mardi Gras, the Collingwood family in Trinidad, the pastor and members of the People's Church St. Paul's, and friends and neighbors of St. Paul's and surrounding areas. The funeral of the late Veronica Crony, also known as Tanti Marge of St. Paul's St. George, will take place on Thursday, 14th March at 12:30 p.m. Funeral service will be held at the People's Church St. Paul's, and entombment will be at the Monjaloo Cemetery. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home. Sebastian Joseph, also known as Teacher Cressy, Basil and Mr. Joe of Laureland St. David, former teacher of the St. Dominic's RC School and retired lecturer of T.A. Marischal Community College, died on Thursday, February 15th, 2024, at the age of 75. He was the husband of Gloria Lewis, father of Don Marie Lewis and WPC 86 Sue Marie Lewis, stepfather of Rachel Paula Alexander, brother of Anthony Joseph and Francis and Christopher Julian, Sonia, Allison and Myrna Julian, and Marlene Lander, grandfather of Syrah J. Paris, uncle of Timoy Joseph and Dawn Daniel, Akeem, Alex, Maxine and Marissa Julian, Andrew and Andrea Dubois, Gabrielle and Elizabeth Lander. Other relatives and friends including Gregory Bowen and family, Rudolph Harris, Dion Mapson, David Fleming and family, teacher Aggie Cherubin, Margaret Simeon and family, Keston Pradam, the Lewis, Noel and Francis families of Westerhall, the Gabriel, Forsyth, and Greenwich families, the Griffith family of Lancepine, the Joseph family of Calivany and St. David, the James family, Cuthbert McMeo and family, Kenneth McKee and family, Dawn Bishop and family, cousins Merrill and Vero, Rosalind Vincent and family, Sylvia Samuel and family, and special appreciation to Dr. Deborah Stephen John and the doctors and nursing staff of the male medical ward of the General Hospital. The funeral of the late Sebastian Joseph, also known as Teacher Cressy, Basil and Mr. Joe, of Laureland St. David, will take place on Thursday, March 14th at 1 p.m. Funeral service will be held at the St. Dominic's RC Church, St. David, followed by private interment. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Bailey's Funeral Home. Jason Dominic Haynes, also known as World Boss and Sayee of Happy Hill St. George, passed away on Saturday, 17th February 2024, at the age of 45, left to mourn his mother, Teresa Haynes, father, Crossford Haynes in the USA, grandmother, Elmina Boatswain in Grenada, brothers, Jarvis Haynes and Keston Boatswain in the USA, uncles, Vaughan Haynes in the USA and Kellen Boatswain in Grenada, aunts, Denise Boatswain in Grenada, Florence Haynes in the USA, Rosalie St. Louis and family in the United Kingdom, cousins Ron, Adrian and Ian Haynes in the USA, Kenesha, Akime, Akimon, Kelowna, Kendall and Cassia. Other relatives and friends, including relatives of the fence at Happy Hill, Aya, Pumpkin, Neil, Godson, the Thomas family, Vera Paul and family, Senator Nealon Franklin and family of Brazan, the Haynes, Amede and Paris families, Pearl John and family, Stanley and the Sylvester family of Grandmall, Lucy Thomas in the USA, the Men and Women by Patrice's Shop, the Charles and Woodruff families, Senator Jonathan Lecret, Dr. the Right Honorable Keith Mitchell, and friends and neighbors of the Fence, Happy Hill, Beausejou and surrounding areas. The funeral of the late Jason Dominic Haynes, also known as World Boss and Sayee of Happy Hill St. George, will take place on Friday, 15th March at 1 p.m. Funeral service will be held at the Happy Hill Open Bible Church and entombment will be at the Top Fence Cemetery. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Bailey's Funeral Home. Davis Michael Hunt, also known as Tommy, of Labbury, who resided at Mount Parnassus, St. George, former employee of Creative Designs Limited and Quinn Company Limited, passed away on Wednesday, 28th February 2024, at the age of 65. He was the husband of Anna Hunt, father of Travis Joseph of the RGPF Traffic Department, stepfather of four, including Dean Bartholomew, grandfather of Tivon and Isaiah Joseph, brother of Carly Thomas in Canada, Heather Colette and Ashley in Trinidad, Maureen Cobbler in the USA, Ulrich Hunt and Greg Coutain, uncle of many including Andrew Hunt, Abigail Moore, Delma, Cassie, Lorna, Legia, Sante and Amanda, brother-in-law of Helen and Gertrude Hunt, Arnold Cobbler, Laslin and Veronica in the USA, father-in-law of Avion Lessie. Many cousins, other relatives and close friends including David Big Ray Charles, Cosmos Pound Charles, The Hunt, Francis, Alexis, Duncan, Sylvester, Thomas and Lord families of Labbury, the Stephen family of Beaulieu, the Crawford family of Frequenty, the Elcock family of Mardi Gras, the Rabin family of Sataz and the Wind family of Marianne, and friends and neighbors of Labbury and Mount Manassas and surrounding areas. The funeral service for the late Davis Michael Hunt, also known as Tommy, of Labbury, who resided at Mount Parnassus St. George, will take place on Monday, 18th March at 1 p.m. Funeral service will be held at the Roxborough Roman Catholic Church St. Paul's and entombment will be at the Mount Airy Cemetery. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home. Josephine Mathewan McQuilkin, also known as Mom, of Harmony Hall, St. David, passed away on Wednesday, 14th February 2024, at the age of 86. She was the mother of Leonora, Gemma, Andre and Wayne in the USA, and Celia in Grenada. Grandmother of many, including Roan, Latoya, Talisha, Chetron, Valisa, Avery and Matthew. Great-grandmother of many. Sister of Floral, Helen also known as Zita, Noreen, Dennis, Desmond, Eddie and Michael. mother-in-law of Wendy Sylvester, sister-in-law of Cherry and Angela McQuilkin, aunt of many, including Tessa, Bertrand, Cheryl, Denny and Carrie, many other relatives and friends, including teacher Mary, Hilda Latouche, Sheila Telesford, Japal, Sean the Barber, Celia Bascom, Randolph Augustine, Brian Whiteman, Frances Purcell, Joy Francis, Bonston and the Chateau family, the Regis, Whiteman and Mark families, the staff of Innovative Healthcare Services Agency, and friends and neighbors in the USA, Canada and Grenada. The funeral service for the late Josephine Mathurin McQuilkin, also known as Mum, of Harmony Hall St. David, will take place on Tuesday, March 19th at 1 p.m. Funeral service will be held at the Church of the Immaculate Conception and St. Joseph, St. David, and interment will be at the St. David Catholic Cemetery. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home. Michael Winston White, of Redhead Street, Satare, St. Patrick, who resided at Gulf Course, St. George, former parliamentarian, published poet, and businessman, passed away on Sunday, 18 February 2024, at the age of 79. He was the father of Robert White, Shermie White Williams, Nicole Roberts, Winston Morgan in St. Vincent, Rixie McLeish Hutchinson, Zandra Forsyth, Nashra Belmar, Michelle Serrano McLeish, Hank Gibbs, Michaela White Nesfield, Shardeen Lutchman Singh, and Fidel Scott. Grandfather of 24, including Ebony White Best, Kizzy Richardson, Brent White, Shanaz Hutchinson, Malik Forsyth, Noah Belmar, Adrian Morgan, Dwight McLeish, Jackson White Loramil, and Nicole Lutchman Singh. Great grandfather of Kyla and Kizelle Richardson, Ivory and Wyatt Best, Zarek Nicholas, and Azariah McLeish. Brother-in-law of Selwyn Woodruff, Joey Francis, Raymond Anthony Joseph, Carl Heisen, Denise Joseph, and Beryl Ann Heisen. Father-in-law of Christopher Hutchinson, Dawn Forsyth, Shane Belmar, Roldy Loramil, Keith Williams, and Nicholas Lutchman Singh. Uncle of many, including Ray, Kishana, Otis, Elvis, Kenneth, Lisa, and Kyle. Many cousins, other relatives and close friends, including Stephen and Hubert White, Naomi Dialli, Ruth John, Norris Jr. White, his caretakers, Teacher Vic, Phyllis Alexis, Cadell Jeremiah, Gussie and brother, other members of the White and Springle families of Chantimel in Trinidad, the USA, Canada and the UK, Reynold Benjamin, Osmo Gall, Carl Medford, former Prime Ministers Dr. the Right Honourable Keith Mitchell and the Honourable Tilman Thomas, and friends and neighbours of Gulf Course, Redhead Street, Satares, and surrounding areas. The funeral service for the late Michael Winston White of Redhead Street, Satares, St. Patrick, who resided at Gulf Course, St. George, will take place on Tuesday, March 19th at 2 p.m., with tributes beginning at 12 noon. Funeral service will be held at the Satares Roman Catholic Church and entombment will be at the Marley Cemetery. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home.
When a loved one passes on, we all need the comfort, support and guidance of a trusted friend. You can rely on Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home. We provide a personalized professional service that exceeds all expectations. Our dedicated staff responds to your every need with the greatest detail, ensuring affordability with a variety of options. Upgraded state-of-the-art facilities, spacious air-conditioned chapel with live internet streaming, a modern, environmentally safe crematorium, the only of its kind on island, private viewing spaces, large on-site repair center, a modern transportation fleet. Join our burial society today and make personalized arrangements for that final moment. As you prepare to enter your loved one into eternal rest, visit or call Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home and select a package that brings added comfort to the entire family. Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home and Burial Society, continuing a tradition of excellence.
Angela Lydia Langine of Concord St. John passed away on Thursday, 15 February 2024. At the age of 60. She was the mother of Nurse Latoya Langine and Gretel Langine in the UK, grandmother of seven. daughter of Dora Langine, sister of Hermelin, Maureen and Martha Wilson in the USA, Miriam, Teresa, Juliet, Vincent, William and Edwin Langine in Grenada, niece of Effie Langine, dear friend of Crystalline Henry, aunt of many, sister-in-law of Mosley Wilson, Keith Marshall and Connie Langine, other relatives and close friends including the Langine, Louison and Alexis families, and friends and neighbors of Concord, Black Bay and surrounding areas. The funeral of the late Angela Lydia Langine of Concord St. John will take place on Wednesday, March 20th at 2 p.m. Funeral service will be held at the Concord RC Church and interment will be at the Power Park Cemetery. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home. Monica Geraldine Batista Murray, better known as Sister Murray, Mammy Monica and Tunka of Berat Pedmatar St. David, passed away on Monday 26th February 2024 at the age of 92. Left to mourn are her children Edris Batiste and Annette Stafford in the USA, Laurel Batiste in Canada, Maureen Hackett, Sharon DeBerg, Allison and Arthur Murray, stepmother of Angela, Oslin and Richard, mother-in-law of Austin Stafford, Anthony Hackett and Victor Charles, grandmother of 19, great-grandmother of 25, several nieces and nephews, including Jean Batiste, her caregiver, other relatives and close friends, including the Alexander family of Berat and St. Paul's, the Murray family of River Road, the Batiste family of Berat and Tempe, Miss Cynthia Davidson, Mrs. Gillian Jilks, Miss Norge Mitchell, the Elcock family of Mardi Gras and the Scott family in Canada, Pastor Anderson Gibson and the congregation of the First Independent Baptist Church of Berat, and Pastor Joachim Philip and congregation of the People's Church St. Paul's, Pastor Andy Murray and family, and friends and neighbors of Berat, Pedmatar and surrounding areas. The funeral of the late Monica Geraldine Batiste Murray, better known as Sister Murray, Mammy Monica and Tunka, of Berat Pedmatar St. David, will take place on Wednesday, March 20th at 1 p.m. Funeral service will be held at the People's Church St. Paul's and interment will be at the Mount Airy Cemetery. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home. Anderson Charles Bean, also known as Maskey and Brother B, of Fontenoy St. George, passed away on Saturday, 9th March 2024, at the age of 84. The funeral arrangements for the late Anderson Charles Bean, also known as Maskey and Brother B of Fontenoy St. George, will be given in a subsequent broadcast. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home. Louisa Griffith, also known as Mrs. Sisley of Bursaju St. George, passed away on Monday, 11th March 2024, at the age of 96. The funeral arrangements for the late Louisa Griffith, also known as Mrs. Sisley of Bursaju St. George, will be given in a subsequent broadcast. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Bailey's Funeral Home. Benedict John Polite, also known as Politics of Florida St. John, passed away on Saturday, 2nd March 2024, at the age of 72. The funeral arrangements for the late Benedict John Polite, also known as Politics of Florida St. John, will be given in a subsequent broadcast. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home. Ira B. Alexis, also known as Dryman, of Florida St. John, passed away on Thursday, March 7th, 2024, at the age of 63. The funeral arrangements for the late Ira B. Alexis, also known as Dryman, of Florida St. John, will be given in a subsequent broadcast. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home. Victor Francis, also known as Rastaman, of Mardi Gras St. George, a well-known farmer, died on Wednesday, March 6th, 2024, at the age of 63. The funeral arrangements for the late Victor Francis Rastaman of Mardi Gras St. George will be given in a subsequent broadcast. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Bailey's Funeral Home. Marilyn Agnes Young of Duquesne, who resided at Nonpareil St. Mark, passed away on Monday, 3rd March 2024 in the USA, at the age of 77. The funeral arrangements for the late Marilyn Agnes Young of Duquesne, who resided at Nonpareil St. Mark, will be given in a subsequent broadcast. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home. Enid Butler, also known as Auntie Enid of St. Dominic Street, Gwharf, St. John, passed away on Tuesday, March 5th, 2024, at the age of 99. The funeral arrangements for the late Enid Butler, also known as Auntie Enid of St. Dominic Street, Gwharf, St. John, will be given in a subsequent broadcast. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home. Brian Christopher, also known as Kitty and Incense Man of Upper Capitol, Birch Grove, St. Andrew, who resided at Mount Rush, St. George, passed away on Wednesday, 6th March, 2024, at the age of 62. The funeral arrangements for the late Brian Christopher, also known as Kitty and Incense Man of Upper Capitol, Birch Grove, St. Andrew, who resided at Mount Rush, St. George, will be given in a subsequent broadcast. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home. Deborah Joseph of Birch Grove, St. Andrew, died on Monday, 26th February 2024, at the age of 55. The funeral arrangements for the late Deborah Joseph of Birch Grove, St. Andrew, will be given in a subsequent broadcast. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Bailey's Funeral Home. Ramon Stephen of Williamson Road, St. George's, passed away on Thursday, 15th February 2024, at the age of 96. The funeral arrangements for the late Ramon Stephen of Williamson Road, St. George's, will be given in a subsequent broadcast. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Lacqua Brothers Funeral Home. Harry Braffett, also known as Terrible and Dr. Hook, of Calivany, St. George, died on Thursday, 22nd February 2024, at the age of 70. The funeral arrangements for the late Harry Braffett, also known as Terrible and Dr. Hook, of Calivany, St. George, will be given in a subsequent broadcast. Funeral arrangements entrusted to Bailey's Funeral Home.
The management and staff of MTV extend deepest condolences to those of you whose loved ones have passed on. Thank you for watching.
Death and dying are the inevitable events and realities of life. The passing of a friend or loved one often brings with it the feeling